All right, Pastor Chris Drennan from Grace Baptist Church, would you come forward and lead us in an invocation, please?
Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege that you've given us to gather here to do the business of this city. We thank you for our leaders and for their burden to help the city to grow and to be a light into our state. Lord, we pray that you would help them in their decisions. Lord, give them wisdom, give them discernment. We pray, Father, as they are burdened with the cares of the people of this city, we ask that you would strengthen them and encourage them. And Lord, help them to lead in the right way. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray that you would help us both morally and spiritually, that we may grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, bless our country, we pray. And Lord, now we pray, bless this meeting, and may you be glorified in everything. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, with that, we open the City of Vero Beach, Florida, October 20th, 2015, regular City Council meeting. Mrs. Vock, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Old?
Here.
Ms. Graves?
Here.
Mrs. Turner?
Here.
Mr. Kramer?
Here.
Mayor Winger?
Here. That gets us to agenda changes, and I have two that I think need to be made, and I'll put them forward. Under 6A, Notice of Scheduled Public Hearing, November 17th, the way this works, it's only read. However, Mr. Kramer is going to bring forward, we discussed yesterday, a visioning plan for the entire area along the beach, and this is the postal annex, and I think it's improper to for us to consider it. It also has not been to the commission, so for that reason, I'd like to remove it for future action. I need concurrence on that.
I agree.
Sure. Great.
Yep. Sounds good.
All right. The other one I have is exactly the same reason, a little different. I completely support this 1,000%, but it is under Consent Agenda 3E, Lease Agreement by and between City of Vero Beach, Florida and Indian River Rowing Club, Incorporated. And I'll bring to your attention that on August 19th, the Marine Commission did the preliminary work on this. And I have here also the I also have the Recreation Commission here who met about the same time. And the issue I have with this is not anything in the agreement, or not that I don't think we should go forward with it, but we have not gone to our commissions, which we almost always do. I think it should go to them before it comes to us, frankly. I don't know whether you concur or just...
Okay, sure.
Fine. I guess both of those commissions have reviewed the concept. Having them review the legalese, this is more or less a standard lease that we've done for other groups. I don't see what else they can add to it, and it would just be a continued delay for the rowing club that have been, you know, waiting for years now to get this lease forward.
Well, you know, they're in talking about that, first of all, there's a dollar value. It's relatively nominal. I think it's $625 for 25 years. I think they would like to deal with that. It really is pretty open-ended. In other words, this is public property, and public property has to be available in one form or another to all the public. And I feel particularly that those two commissions would have views on, you know, saying, okay, we wrestled with this. We sent it back and forth to committee with the dog park to be sure that there was public access. And I really think it needs to be vetted in those two respects. So I don't concur with you, Mrs. But I'll go with the majority.
No, I'm fine with it. I think, I've got a lot of people that are asking about the trees, and it's got a big swath of land. So I think there's some people that would like to ask some questions.
Yeah, and that gives us, that gives a format. That's why we have commissions. I don't think going around them is a good idea.
I'm not suggesting going around them. We have been to these commissions. This is not, it will go to the Planning Commission for when it has their site preparation, et cetera. This is essentially a legal document, and yeah. I want to delay them further. That's majority's call.
I'll make a motion that it go next to the commissions and then come back to us. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Opposed.
Okay. 4-1.
Okay. Staff have changes?
Staff, do you have changes? Are there further changes?
Staff has no changes.
Motion to approve agenda as modified.
All right. We have no proclamations. That brings us to public.
Mr. Mayor, I think you're going to need a second to that to adopt the agenda with modifications.
I'm sorry.
But just so you understand, Shotzi and I have talked today, and she's still going to get access to do some test borings out there on the site. So we're going to be working through that process.
I think that's wonderful. Okay, I'll make a motion to adopt the agenda with those two changes. Is there a second?
All right, second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It carries 5-0. All right, that brings us to public comment. Who would like to come forward, please? Mrs. Manus.
Good evening, Council. I'm Honey Manus. I live at 27 Starfish Drive. I'm not representing anyone in my comments. They're my own, as simply as someone who lives here and loves my city. I'd like to congratulate you on the revised contract with OUC. It's going to bring lower rates to all the electric customers. I've been watching the Finance and the Utility Commission meetings on television as they work through all these details. And of course, yesterday I watched on TV when it culminated with your vote to accept those revisions. It's taken us a long time to get here and a lot of work by many people. And I really give my congratulations with thanks and appreciation for your persistent efforts. It means a lot. Hasn't been easy to get here to lower these rates. In the beginning, we knew we were always bound by those FMPA contracts. They were legal, they were upheld by the Supreme Court, and we couldn't get out of them. And it prevented the sale of the utility to FPNL. Then you worked with your Land or Utilities Commission, the OUC, to see what could be done. And the fact that you were able to renegotiate the terms of our contract with them is really remarkable. And I would particularly like to thank Chef Wright for his work on our behalf. He has been particularly challenged in what he was doing. Revising contracts and negotiating terms is not something that's done every day, especially in the energy field. And when this all started, I recall Chef sitting here in the front row at a council meeting. I don't think he was under contract at the time, or he may have just been starting. Anyway, he was a relatively new face sitting here during a council meeting. And at that meeting, he was viciously and verbally attacked from this very spot where I'm standing by an individual who is known for spewing that kind of venom. And I remember Chef turning around and looking at everyone who was seated here in the chambers, and I was here that night, and he had a questioning look on his face, and the attack went on and on and on. Perhaps you all remember this, saying awful things about his abilities and about his credentials. And I remember very clearly Chef raised his arms to his side. He held his hands out and upwards, and he was shaking his head, looking at everybody who was seated here. And his face began to register a look of complete disbelief, like, where did this come from, and what's going on here? That public display of that despicable behavior was a very new low for us to reach at that time. I wanted to apologize for that person's behavior, his hateful words, but you can't apologize for another person's misdeeds. And I bring back that unfortunate episode because it's worthy of mention now, because Chef weathered that personal attack on himself, and over time he worked professionally with everybody, literally everybody, to get us where we are at this point in time. I know we worked with FPL, FMPA, OUC, on and on. And I expect during that process that Chef learned that the hate that that individual was spewing was not what we were all about here in Vero Beach, that there are good, decent, and hardworking people living here. That includes you, our elected officials, includes our city manager, our staff, and the many who volunteer their services, such as we have on our finance and utility commissions, who all have worked very hard on that. But with Chef's diligent work, you were all able to bring forward together this negotiated revision to our existing OUC contract. And it benefits every single customer of Vero Electric, no matter where they live, because it's going to lower rates. Granted, not FPL rates, but lowered rates. And importantly, we were advised that this amended contract providing for these lower rates will in no way interfere with or prohibit a sale to FPL if a way is found to go forward. So thank you, everyone. You know who you are, for your hard work and your dedication to this city and every customer of Vero Electric. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Who else would like to come forward? Mr. Hedy, by all means.
One of the wonderful things about living in a nation where there's freedom of speech is that each and every one of us can come to this public podium and we can express our viewpoint. And there was no personal attack against the lawyer in question, but there certainly were lots of things said about his credentials. And I would hope that in this city, we continue to have people that are willing to come forward and are willing to express their point of view and do so if the lawyer in question had a counter to any of the things said about him. He was certainly free to come to the podium and express those points of view. To categorize this individual as spewing hate, I think, is less than productive. I think if his report on the individual was incorrect, there's plenty of opportunity. You know, we have an election coming up in 2016, and one of the candidates, Donald Trump, is accused of that same kind of thing all the time. You know, and he spews hate and he calls people names, and the party loyalists in his party are against him. The other party, the whole party, is against him, and yet he continues to garner 50% of the polls. So there's something to be said for standing up and saying out loud for the public to hear those things that that you believe to be true. And someone told me, Brian Hedy, you're the Donald Trump of Vero Beach. Well, I would argue Donald Trump is the Brian Hedy of the United States, but at any rate, the comments on the OUC and the voting to approve it and all of the work that this particular lawyer went through, I would make the argument that it's unfortunate that he didn't spend the same time and the same effort to get the rates that were promised to the council that voted in favor of the original contract. And there's a member of that city council that voted for the original sitting here in the audience, and I know that he's taken lots of heat. He's taken heat from me about that contract. But after a thorough research and after all of the facts came out, and he voted for a contract that was promised that we were going to get 20% lower rates. He's not the bad guy. Afterwards, after he voted for a contract that was going to give us rates similar to FPL, something happened to the contract, and it was just a recent meeting, Mr. Kramer, and you said, you still never don't know what happened to the original. Nobody does. And anyway, something happened to the contract, and it came back. And that gentleman was no longer on the council, and the council debated, and the city attorney at the time said, don't worry about it, Councilman Hedy. I was on at the time, it's back in 2009. Don't worry about it, Councilman Hedy. The only thing that was changed was the numbers. right? You remember? Yeah. The only thing that was changed was the numbers. Yeah, well, that's what affected us. That's what affected us, was the numbers. And you're signing up with this same organization that changed the numbers and came back and charged us more than they said they were going to charge us in the contract. Well, I don't get that, and I certainly don't applaud going back into business with someone who's cheated us for a lot of years. The contract speaker before me said that nothing in the contract prevents us from selling to FPNL at some time where we can find a way. Well, how about we start by selling the Indian River Shores portion? It's roughly 10%, so that's roughly $18 million. Sell it to FPNL. In fact, you can make a really good deal with FPNL. Tell them to give us $1 million a month in the next 18 months. That's income for the city. The county's roughly 50%, so that's $90 million. Sell the county their portion. The county and Indian River Shores will be happy campers. They'll be getting FPNL rates. And we'll be getting a heck of an income. And FMPA and no other entity can come back and say we went out of the electrical business because we didn't. The city of Vero Beach still maintains an electrical utility, except that we maintain it within our corporate limits. But the lawyers will keep up the OUCs and keep up the Orlando coming in and lying, cheating, and stealing from the ratepayers in our county. The lawyers keep it up because the lawyers continue to make lots of money. I don't know how many millions of dollars have been spent on the lawyers. And I'm not real sure that this city council has the legal authority to retroactively approve different rates than the other council voted for. This contract retroactively approves what they've been doing, which is stealing from us, overcharging us for years. I'm not sure you have the legal right to do that. Your lawyer will argue that you do, but I think that your current city attorney has often given you legal opinions that support his former boss, who was kicked out of here for changing just the numbers. At any rate, there is an election coming up. People should know who's on it and who's in it and what they stand for. And if they don't know the names, then they probably shouldn't go vote. It was interesting, there was today, I was just getting back from helping the vets at West Palm, and you know where the railroad crosses there at 14th Avenue? There was an elderly gentleman and a walker who apparently had a blowout or something, and his tire went off and his car was stuck on the railroad tracks. And I was one of the first on the scene, and I dialed 911. And when talking with 911, police department, city of Beach, we are one of the reasons why we should have a city police department, city of Vero Beach police show up. Good job, city of police, and Mr. Rivers. And anyway, several of us that saw the thing all stopped. And it seemed to me the important thing to do right now is to get the car off the railroad tracks. So I said to a bunch of the guys there, I says, what do you think? Can we push it? And one guy says, well, I've got a truck. And another guy says, I got a strap. So I jumped under the car and wrapped the strap around the frame. And the guy wrapped it around his truck. And with the police department blocking traffic, we pulled the car off the railroad track and prevented what could have been a serious situation. But it was a good example of where the public stops what they're doing in this city. They don't just drive by. they stop in the city and they see what they can do to help. So anyway, thanks to the police department, they did a good job in that example. Before the meeting, Jay talked to me about one of the vets and one of the things he was instrumental in helping out one of the vets. And those of you who know, and the flag shirt is a uniform. I work with the vets every day of the week. But anyway, one of the things that has been talked about just recently is cutting out the medical transportation for the vets on one day a week. And here's what I think. I think it's appalling that we as a nation promise these people, when they sign the bottom line and say, yeah, I'll go off to help defend this nation, and they sign the bottom line, and we say, okay, if you do that, if you put your life on the line, here's what we're going to do for you. And one of the things we're going to do is we're going to provide for your medical needs. And then we wind up, oh, well, there's a budget problem. And we can only provide for your medical needs on Monday through Thursday. We can't provide Friday. And after talking with you prior to the meeting, you know, the thought occurred to me, Jay. This is within your city manager's spending limits. We can solve that one day a week problem pretty easily. And I can tell you how to do it. Have your city manager stroke a check for 10 grand. It's within his spending limits, and it will put Friday back on the agenda, and our vets will get transportation the rest of the Fridays for the next fiscal year for $10,000. And my goodness, you spend a fortune on lawyers and all kinds of things. And you can do it. In fact, you don't even need a vote. If you do, you just, without objection, just send a message down to the city manager to stroke the check, and I can meet with them and tell them how to make the check out, what to do, and we'll guarantee that the vets in our community and our city will have transportation every day instead of 4 days. It's $10,000. So maybe somebody wants to say, city manager, stroke the check.
I think it's worth looking at. I'd like to know where it came from and who had the responsibility ahead of time.
Who, where, what came from, and who has the responsibility?
Well, who took Fridays off?
I'm the supervisor of transportation.
Right.
And they're directing me that because of budget constraints.
Who's directing you?
The Veterans Council.
Veterans Council, okay.
And I have strongly objected to that, and I think that, you know, we can solve the problem right here in the city.
Brian, I think we I'll take whatever lead, and I'm sure the rest of the council will, that Jay gives us. I mean, you know, so.
Well, I sincerely believe in talking to the Veterans Council about it.
But talk to me about it. I'm the supervisor of transportation.
Okay. I will do that.
Dynamite. Thank you. I'd love to see the vets be guaranteed and reassured that their medical needs are taken care of. We owe it to them as a nation.
Absolutely.
You know, it's sad. I went to the veterans thing in, you know, event in Gifford, but so many people come out of our military and there are no jobs, they're not treated properly, they can't get medical attention. I mean, we all read about it, so I mean, we're all concerned.
Well, I'm involved in it every day of the week.
Oh, and thank you for doing that. That's a wonderful thing you do.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Who would like to come up, Mrs. Moss?
Laura Moss, Utilities Commission member at large, Vero Beach. Wasn't planning to speak about this evening. I didn't realize Ms. Manus would be making comments. But in that regard, I think, you know, of course the rates will be slightly lower, but it's a matter of opinion that we took Mr. Wright's advice in this regard. He advised due diligence in the form of requests for proposals, which for the public would be that other bidders participate, not just OUC. We were prevented from doing that, so we didn't have any other bids. We were negotiating with only one source, and that prevented us from obtaining truly lower rates. In addition to that, we gave away, basically transferred the rights to our gas transportation, which is worth at least $10 million. In the previous contract, the rights were going to revert back to us as a city. Now OUC will keep them permanently. And in addition to that, it looks like there could be further legal entanglements, and that we'll be obligated to litigate with OUC, basically at their choosing. It was unanimous, by the way, that we go and get these bids. The Finance Commission voted unanimously, the Utilities Commission voted unanimously, and City Council voted unanimously to obtain those other bids. With regard to passing this contract, it was not unanimous. On the Utilities Commission itself, I opposed it, as well as one of my colleagues on that commission. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comment. Who else would like to come forward? I see no one, I guess. Was there someone? I see no one. I'll close public comment then. That brings us to the consent agenda. It now no longer has E on it.
It no longer has F.
It no longer has F. Thank you for the correction. Are there other changes in this? Anything anybody wants to pull?
I'd like to pull H, just have a question, and G and H, please.
All right, G and H are pulled.
Motion to approve consent agenda.
Public needs to comment on the rest of it.
All right, public comment, and there are eight remaining items here, if anyone has any comment on them. Okay, I'll close public comment.
Cue the motion.
I need a motion.
Motion to approve consent agenda as modified.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It passes 5-0. Go ahead. You have the floor, Mrs. Turner.
And item G, once again, just a quick question. This is for painting at the Public Works compound. We had an original budget estimate of $40,000, and the bids came back at $60,000. Did we add scope? Are we that bad at estimating? What in the world happened?
Bonnie, you might want to address the estimating.
Monty Falls, Director of Public Works. You know, when you prepare a construction estimate, I've probably done 500, you can be two things, right or wrong. So we had an estimate of 40,000. The bids came in, there was a wide range. The successful contractor has done some work for us recently at a lot less money than we had bid for the traffic signals downtown. So we feel comfortable that he has given us a good price for the work that's to be done. It was outlined in the specifications, but we don't have enough money in the budget this year to accomplish the whole task.
Well, like I said, I've done budgets, but when you blow it by, it's twice the.
Well, it's important to note that the bids were $60,000 to $202,000, so
they're pretty huge.
Broad. And I think the market has changed a little bit, where there is more demand for services. So obviously, competition is pretty heavy. So I think that when he was putting this together, which would have been back in probably January.
Or before.
Okay, because actually we had so many in
there. The market has changed since January, for sure, on construction.
Yeah, and we actually had money in it last year, just couldn't get it done, so.
Okay.
And some of our colleagues in the private sector have stopped calling them construction estimates and engineers' opinion of probable cost just because of these things. And
come on, Nick, you've got to watch.
We don't do that. I'm just telling you what some of our colleagues do.
It only work out. With that explanation, I'll move for approval.
I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It passes 5-0.
And on item number H, which is the wastewater treatment plant's solid handling modification, this is another one where it looks like we have overrun the the budget. We've got another $183,000 to come out. Where do
actually, the budget's going to be overrun by $54,888. And the reason for that is after our visit to Fort Pierce, seeing the Clean Bee system installed down there, we looked at the type of building. We were looking at putting a processing building that would have gone into like a dumpster. And then the handling of that was going to be very inefficient. What we saw at Fort Pierce is the building was built a little higher. They dump it into trucks and in the flatbed or into the dump trucks, and they're able to take it much more efficient in a way and do it. So this modification really is the modification to the building itself where we're going to be.
And there's a savings going forward on the transportation.
Yeah. It should be a savings. Efficiency, hopefully, in the whole overall operation.
Yeah, over time, it will save the $54,000. But it also saves us time and energy, what we're doing down there.
Okay.
And again, we give a little credit to Fort Pierce because we were able to see a couple of modifications, what they were doing, that we made modifications to our bids. For example, there was a piping for some acid that, in our opinion, was sort of exposed to where people could have tripped and fell. So we put that inside, and we did those type of modifications. With those modifications were some costs.
You know, if anybody hasn't seen the Fort Pierce operation, I have. It's a pretty neat operation, and the way it works is the semi-solid material, of course, it's got a lot of moisture still in it, is turned into agricultural mulch, but it comes out of the centrifuge area on a belt that takes it up and then drops it into an open gondola truck, and it's really a pretty neat operation, and it allows the closing of the digesters, which is very beneficial both environmentally and odor-wise and cosmetically and space-wise and all the rest of it. It's a neat process. We're working very well at Fort Pierce.
I move for approval.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? None. So it passes 5-0. All right, that'll move us to 4A. An ordinance to the City of Vero Beach, Florida, amending the Land Development Regulations, Part 2 of the Code of the City of Vero Beach, relating to medical marijuana dispensaries, providing for conflict and severability, providing for an effective date, requested by the Planning and Development Director. Staff comment, and this one has been modified. I think Mr. Old had objections to it, so I'll let him ask questions. Why don't you tell us how it's been modified? No, I mean, he was the one that brought up the question.
Was I? Okay. Did I bring that up?
Well, what is it?
Well,
it's been modified.
I think we've gone back and forth and back and forth about how far from residents and are the residents there.
And that was the issue that came up, and I explained that in the agenda, that there are residents in non-residential zones within so many feet. And we did take a look at it. The 1,000-foot separation from parks, schools, and daycare facilities is not really germane because of the positioning of where the manufacturer or the industrial zoning is. Basically, it's a distance thing. So in discussions, the city attorney talked with Mr. Daig about it, and the suggestion came up to put another clause in there that would basically be a separation at least 200 feet from residential. And I think that's clearly it would reduce the eligible area somewhat, but I think it's a workable solution. Certainly the ordinance you have before you, I certainly can support that, as I point out in my amendment. I think in my staff report, obviously we do not, the staff would not support the do-nothing approach. We don't think that's appropriate, nor trying to just ban marijuana. We don't think in the long run that's the best. So unless you have some specific questions of me, you could open it to a hearing.
Yes, public comment. Would someone like to comment on this? Yes, come forward, Mr. Daig.
I'm Ken Daig, 1846 21st Avenue, and my wife Deborah Daig, we are at the same address. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to the City Council for allowing this a little bit more time, and you tabled it, and you allowed us to sit down with your city attorneys, and we reached a compromise. Mr. McGarry was okay with it, and we're very thankful for that, and I think it will protect folks in that area. It's a little bit more protections, and I know you as a whole, as a council, wanted to do as much as you possibly could to protect your people. And I would ask that you would please go with Mr. McGarry's, which he calls the staff recommendation, and approve option one. We would really appreciate that, and the folks in that area would appreciate it. And again, thanks for your time and allowing us time to work with your city attorneys and Mr. McGarry's staff. Thanks.
Any further public comment? Mrs. Vega or anyone else?
Just wanted to say thank you for taking the time to do this.
All right, we'll close public comment. I have a question before we have a council discussion. Is this one tabled or is this a new resolution?
This is the final public hearing.
Final public hearing, okay. Council discussion or resolution as you see fit?
I'd like to see us move forward with the option one. And I'm glad to see us continue to be proactive to upcoming legislative items. I think you don't want to get caught shorthanded again, so I'm glad to see us move forward. Thank you.
If that's a motion, I'll second it. All right, all in favor? Oh, it requires a roll call.
Mr. Old?
Yes.
Ms. Graves?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Mr. Kramer?
Yes.
Mayor Winger?
Yes. All right, that moves us to 4B, an ordinance of the City of Vero Beach, Florida, requested by Promised Land Anglican Church to amend the comprehensive plan future land use map by changing the future land use designation from government institutional public use to residential low for the property located at 665 20th Street, containing 15 acres more or less, providing for an effective date requested by the Planning and Development Director. Mrs. Bach, is this a final on this or what?
Yes, sir. This is the final public hearing.
All right. And then for the public, this is the land where the school was, so that you'll understand where it is. Staff comment, please, with that.
Not a lot of comment. As you well know, you transmitted this to the Department of Economic Opportunity on the 18th of August. It's come back. All the reviews have been done by the state agency. There are no comments on it. The staff's recommended we move forward with approval.
All right, public comment, please. I see no public comment. I'll close it. Either council discussion or the motion as you see fit.
Move for approval.
Second.
Just for clarification, I mean, the property was bought for a church property?
Yes.
Okay. And then that's going to residential low.
The underlying zonings are one already. So the problem was that the future land use designation prohibit almost everything on the property, including residential. It's one of those quirks in our that we've had in the comp plan. If you all recall, I think I brought it up when the lower St. Ed's school, we had to change that. So
okay.
All right, I call a motion, Mrs. Bach.
Mr. Old?
Yes.
Ms. Graves?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Mr. Kramer?
Yes.
Mayor Winger?
Yes, it passes 5-0. That brings us to 4C, an ordinance of the City of Vero Beach, Florida, amending Chapter 26, Cemetery of the Code of the City of Vero Beach, Florida, relating to sale of burial rights and related services, reflecting changes in cemetery plat, adding new sections, providing for a conflict and severability, providing for codification, providing for an effective date, requested by the Public Works Director. And down below it, it has plat apportioned section J and K, Crestlawn Cemetery.
What this is doing, Mr. Mayor, is that we're uniforming the regulations into these new plats from our present regulations. For example, the headstones on the ground and that type of stuff. But it's also replatting, giving us more space.
All right. Is there a public comment in this? Seeing no public comment, I'll close public comment. Either
move for approval.
Second.
Ms. Graves, second.
Discussion, please.
By all means.
When this ordinance was brought up earlier, I brought up the question about if we had explored other revenue sources for the cemetery, whether it was the closing, and that there was some equipment that said maybe we needed to be able to do that in the cemetery. But he said, this was being done by other people. And I thought, well, if it's revenue that we could generate for the city, if we have most of the equipment, the trucks, and the people, why not do it ourselves?
Well, we did explore that. You were talking about the actual digging of mm-hmm. the graves, and it does require some specialized equipment that we would have to make some capital purchases, and we're not sure that in the foreseeable that we would be able to regain the cost of those. Over time, a longer period of time, you would, but it's just not a business that we'd be very good in. Plus, we would have to have the labor to do it, because when somebody calls in for a gravesite to be dug, it's not like you can wait, you know, a week or so. It's done.
And so it's more a scheduling thing with the amount of labor that we have then.
That is correct. Sure. It is that in the capital investment.
Would this expansion of these plats increase any maintenance costs?
No, I think we already own the ground, so, Monty?
Monty Falls, Director of Public Works. This land is already on the cemetery. We're already mowing it. It'll incrementally increase it because we'll have, as the site is developed and graves are placed there, we'll have the shell place between the grave spaces where the headstones go, and that'll require some edging around them. But generally, we mow it and take care of it now, and it would be brought on incrementally as the spaces were sold.
I know it's probably a crazy thing to be asking about a cemetery, but I mean, as far as when do we, how quickly do you think we're going to recover that $2,000 investment as far as selling those plots?
Well, I pulled up what we've done for this year just to take a look at it. So what we estimated revenue for the cemetery this year, we estimated at $166,000. That's what was in the budget. And as of the end of this fiscal year, and I verified it with Ms. Lawson before the meeting, we're at about $191,000. So the sales were a little better this year, and that's something there's really no way to predict. But the sales and the amount of fees that we collected for opening and closings and staking out graves was, you know, about 15% more than we had estimated.
Okay, thank you.
Motion, please.
There is a motion and a second.
All right. I'll call the motion then.
Mr. Rold?
Yes.
Ms. Graves?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Mr. Kramer?
Yes.
Mayor Winger?
Yes. Okay, that moves us to five resolutions. A resolution of the City of Vero Beach, Florida, requesting the Treasure Coast Legislative Delegation to support a proposal requiring staff analysis for proposed legislation to indicate whether the proposal is an unfunded mandate or impacts the home rule of Florida municipalities requested by the Treasure Coast Regional League of Cities. This one will take some explanation. Who's got that, Jim? You or you, Wayne?
We do have a representative. Councilman Kramer, I think, is representative.
The way you read that, it didn't sound at all like what I'd put on there.
I didn't read it very well, but it was hard to read too.
No, you did a wonderful job. I think the way it was written, it didn't come across. What happens is that the Florida League of Cities do have these resolutions, and this is a very typical one. And I believe the resolution is already written up and just needs us our agreement to it. But the you know, maybe it's not fair that we vote on this because we don't have that resolution in front of us now. But the gist of the resolution is that the Florida League of Cities wants to be able to go to Tallahassee and express to the legislation that there's be no more unfunded mandates. Unfunded mandates being, you know, Tallahassee passes a law and then we are the ones that has to enforce the law and pay for the law. The idea being that if the legislature up there at Tallahassee and the state there, if they're going to pass a law, then they need to be able to pay for it up there and not down here. It's up to the council, but what this is typically we just join in with the rest of the cities and saying no more unfunded mandates to the legislature.
I have no problem with it. Although we should have public comment too.
I think it's a great idea, at least to try to put the state legislature on notice, especially as when they passing legislature that infringes on what we call our home rule, our ability to make our laws for our municipal community. However, I would certainly say send a letter endorsing it, but without being able to look at the resolution itself and to know how it's worded, I don't see how we can vote.
We'll bring it back around with the language.
Well, you have the resolution in front of you. This is what the League of Cities proposed.
And actually, what it, all it does is it asks the legislature for each bill to put on there those two subjects, whether or not the bill includes an unfunded mandate and whether or not it impacts home rule. That's all that they asked for.
If that's all it is, then I would,
they just asked that
for approval. Yeah.
That they're asking the legislature to make that part of every bill, basically.
Any public comment on this? Seeing none. And then I guess I had a motion anyway, so I'll call the motion, Mrs. Vaugh.
Mr. Old?
Yes.
Ms. Graves?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Mr. Kramer?
Yes.
Mayor Winger?
Yes. That brings us to 6B, A having been removed. And all I'm doing here for the public is I'm reading something that will go into the City Council agenda of November 17th. It's kind of a warning. We will not be talking about it today. So it reads as follows. A resolution of the City Council of the City of Vero Beach, Florida, determining that certain city-owned real property containing 35.24 acres located south of 26th Street and east of 43rd Avenue, commonly referred to as the Dodger Town Golf Course, is no longer needed by the city, and authorizing city manager to offer said real property for sale, providing for conflict, severability, and providing for an effective date, requested by City Council. And that's pretty much it, unless someone has comment.
And it's just public notice that this is scheduled for public hearing November 17th at 6 p.m.
All right, that brings us to City Clerk matters. Mrs. Vaugh.
My first item is we received an application from Mr. Stephen McDonald, who is interested in serving on one of our city boards and commissions. He has shown an interest in the Planning and Zoning Board, which we have no openings, the Historic Downtown Vero Beach Economic Development Zone Advisory Committee, which we have two alternate positions open on that one, and then the Code Enforcement Board, which there is a full position open as well as two alternate positions. Open.
Did you ask him his preference?
He felt wherever we really needed him to serve.
I would say code.
Yeah, he ranked code enforcement as his third choice, but since we have a full opening there, that's where I'd like to see him serve.
I think he's qualified to do it. What do you need? Do you need a vote or just a...
Yes, sir.
Motion to appoint Mr. Stephen McDonald to the Code Enforcement Board.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passes 5-0. What, go on, Mrs. Vaugh.
And my other item was we received a notice from the Florida League of Mayors that they were asking if we would like to renew our membership fee. We have not done that since 2011, but I received like two or three notices from them. So I talked to the mayor and he said, go ahead and put it on the agenda and see if council wants to renew that membership fee or not. It is $350 a year.
What benefits come from that versus just a regular membership in the Florida League of Cities?
I don't think a whole lot. When we had it before, the mayor at that time was very involved with the Florida League of Cities. So he was going to the meetings and staying along with the mayor, the Florida League of Mayors, and going to all their meetings. But we haven't not been involved with the Florida League of Mayors in some time. So
I think we skip it, personally.
Me too. I certainly think we could skip it. I think it's great because the City of Vero Beach and our charter, you know, the mayor's not elected by the overall public. The mayor's elected by the council for a one-year period. And we've had, you know, a good turn, and because we have that regular turnover. The mayor's not given any additional powers of any other council member here other than to conduct this meeting. So it's a very different type when you're looking at other cities where their mayors are there for long, four-year, long-term, or, you know.
Yeah, there's two forms of government, city manager and strong mayor. We have city manager form of government. It's accurately stated. So I think the consensus is we can skip it.
Yep. All right. Thank you.
Okay. City managers, do you have further matters?
No, sir. That's it.
City managers meeting?
First of all, I just want to thank you for your form of government.
You like thinking.
The one item that I have on the agenda is, you remember, the City Council authorized to get appraisals of properties at the Postal Annex. That is the property over on 17th and Dodger Town, which you read the resolution or heard the resolution titled today. And in both of those cases, we did get the appraisals. Armfield Wagner Appraisal and Research did the work for us. The Postal Annex appraisal was $2 million. The Dodger Town was $3.5 million. $1,000. If, in fact, that you do continue and declare the Dodgertown Golf Course as surplus property, we will proceed doing a request for proposals on that site using the 3.5 as our minimum bid, since that's the appraised value.
Personally, I think we should move ahead with Dodgertown property, get it back on the tax roll.
I'll second that.
We will proceed down that route. This is for information primarily. And then once you pass that resolution, assuming you do at the next or the 17th, then we will proceed with that request for proposals.
Sounds good.
All right. I don't guess you have consensus. That's all you need.
Yes, this was primarily informational, but in case there were some objections, I'm not sure that I anticipated any of that. But if there are any questions from the mayor and council, I'll be very happy to try to address it.
Public.
I have a, on that subject or other subjects?
Any subject.
Okay. One thing in the Press Journal, there was the implication, and I believe it's inaccurate. I'd like you to address it, Jim. I think where we are now on the power plant, Big Blue as it's nicknamed, is that, tell us where you believe we are. The implication was that somehow or another it could turn into another power plant, and I don't think that's accurate.
No, we're proceeding down the route. We did the request for the transmission study. The transmission study came back. It was performed by Florida Power and Light, since they're going to have to provide the transmission for us to purchase power onto our system. And it gave the conditions in which we could discontinue generating power at the power plant. Those conditions, we think, have been met. It will now go to the Florida Reliability Coordinating Committee. We do not anticipate any issues there. Primarily, it's going to be the processes in which we can connect and disconnect from the grid, something that we already have in place anyway, so it's not a change. We will be upgrading some transformer conditions, but they're well within the parameters of the manufacturer's parameters of those transformers, so we don't think that's going to be an issue. Once that comes back, what we will do, and we've already started this plan, is trying to figure out how we are going to take the plant and try to see what appraisals we can get on the materials and the equipment, for example, the generators inside the plant, and put those out on the open market. We've already been contacted by a couple of firms who are specialized in going into power plants and taking the materials out. But we could probably do an RFP on that. I have also asked the electric superintendent to start preparing a plan of options that we have on the power plant. As you know, we have a major substation there with a portion of that substation within the building itself. And what would it take if we wanted to take the building down? How would we protect that substation? What would it require if we wanted to relocate that substation to another site on that property? And that's the limits that we're going to put is on that property itself. As to what conditions would we take the building down, we do know that, as an example, when we empty the fuel oil, we'll probably take those tanks off. There's no reason to have those tanks there. It will take some demolition of the containment area underneath that we will have to take care of and resolve. Then we have the cooling tower issue that we can probably do demolition on that. It would be my hope that we would be able to get enough revenue out of the surplus materials that we would sell that would be able to help us take care of those issues. Taking down the building is a totally different picture, and that's something that we as a commission, or you as a city council, are going to have to address. But hopefully we'll come back with some of those options and also cost factors that will be involved in that exercise.
There's been this debate about what is underneath it and what how bad is it.
And Randy, you voiced your opinion on that. Before we start doing any drilling, let me give you an example. Yeah. The diesel plant.
Yeah, I want to find
we got our permits over at the diesel plant.
Find it.
And as long as it's not migrating out, there was no hesitation from the Department of Environmental Protection to give us a permit to use that site.
Mm-hmm.
when you start disturbing the ground, especially underneath that slab, you start asking for issues and troubles. And I think what we'll do is try to give you a much clearer picture of that. But again, we probably would not have to address that issue unless, of course, we start taking the building down. And that's going to be another number that we're going to have to come up with as to how to make that work.
And maybe the knowledge of the history of the site would be nice.
Yeah. We can try to do that.
Yeah.
Jim, this is a yes or no question. Is there any possibility of any third party, whether OUC or some other party coming in? Well, is there any possibility of OUC having any option to use the property for anything?
No, sir. You've eliminated the OUC options.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks to the hard work of our commissions, the finance and utilities that asked Mr. Wright to go back and get that done for us. So thank you.
Yeah, you know, the commissions, and this is the reason I earlier pushed some things to the commission that I personally was okay with. For the public, those two commissions met something like 10 or 10 and a half hours, and they went over every line of the amendment to the original 2008 OUC contract, and at least three beneficial changes, possibly more, came out of that, and it was well worth doing. So that's accurate, Mrs. Turner. I agree with you. Anything else for the city manager? All right, for the city attorney.
I don't have anything unless somebody has a question.
All right, that brings us to City Council matters. I had just two things to report. One, we had the meeting of the three cities, Ellesmere, Sebastian, and Vero Beach, moving forward. And we were seated, I believe, on October 9th on the Indian River Coalition. This is four counties, the two north and the two south, plus the Indian River County is now being represented by the three cities. And that has occurred. Actually, we've cut our check for one-third of the $50,000. There was one comment that Chairman Gilmore, who's Mayor Sebastian, but chairman of our group of three, wanted to come back with. And that is, and I think we've already done one, but it's important for us to put in front of this group projects we have that we need help with that would aid the river. And a piece of that is education. In other words, anything we do in the way of education makes it higher in the priority. The other comment I had about this coalition, probably not generally known, but the coalition is going to be headquartered. It does have an executive director. I had his name as Dwayne, but Dwayne DeFries. It will be headquartered in a building adjacent to Sebastian City Hall and be near us, which I think is beneficial. That makes a lot of sense because, you know, it's counties north and south of us, so it's rather a central location. So we are moving forward on that. The only other thing that I had, we had an excellent example of working together and Go Play Vero. If you haven't been to the Humiston Playground, the ribbon was cut on Saturday. These young women, three in particular, but more in general, raised over $250,000 to really upgrade this playground, and it's a commendable accomplishment. It's a great addition to the city, and they are to be commended for it. In fact, I think we should think about giving them a proclamation.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And that ends my comments. Chairman Kramer, I mean Vice Mayor Kramer.
Well, I did attend the National Night Out, and I want to say a great big thanks to our police officers and sheriff's department that showed up there, and had to have the hot dogs with Kevin, so I mean it seems to be a tradition now. But they did a great job, and I'm glad they were out there for everybody and gave everybody the opportunity to jump in the cars and do the lights. We had a good meeting over at the airport with Elite Airwaves coming in. I don't know if
too many people were there, but we had some good people there, and we're going to be having regular flight service from Vero Beach to Newark, New Jersey. Leaving on Thursday and coming back on Sunday, so it'll be a great opportunity to get up into that area for a weekend. I believe the flights are $250 for a round trip flight right now.
They started $149. Let me. This is meant as levity, but whoever is mayor of Vero Beach gets a free ticket on the first flight on December 10th to the Big Apple. There is a problem, though. There's not a return ticket. So all of you are contending to be elected mayor of Vero Beach. You have a one-way ticket on Elite Airways on December 10th. Go ahead, Jay. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
That's good. The also participated in the Lions to the Lagoon. Was a rather windy day, and had an awful lot of boys out there, and then a few girls out there on the river. And this next year, I'm going to have to talk to them about getting a prize for the biggest tarp. And unfortunately, it wasn't in the cards this time around. But we had an opportunity to raise an awful lot of money for the lagoon, and got a lot of kids actively involved, and we had a wonderful time.
Mister.
Attended the Metropolitan Planning Organization meeting. And it was interesting to note that the Federal Department of Transportation's budget has been decreased by $92 million this year because of Amendment 1. Apparently part of the dock stamp revenue that we used to go to Department of Transportation was now shifted over to Amendment 1. On a more positive note, they approved a new standard for new roads that now they're going to have a 7-foot wide bicycle lane, which I think will be great. Hopefully it'll give us more bicycle safety. And one of the nicest things was Indian River County Metropolitan Planning Organization was named Outstanding MPO by the National Association. It was recognized among over 200 small and mid-sized MPOs in the country for successfully advancing and promoting metropolitan transportation planning. And a couple of the initiatives that were recognized here in Indian River County with our MPO was our bicycle safety rodeo training program that's trained over almost 14,000 children in the county. The trails plans, Trans Central Florida Rail Trail, the Lagoon Greenway, and Martin Luther King Trail, expansion of our GO Line system, and being acknowledged as a bicycle-friendly community. We are one of only two counties in the state that have that designation. So I think that's a lot to be proud of on our Metropolitan Planning Group. Notice that downtown, they are going to start the shuttle bus for those for the art stroll beginning in November, the first Friday in November, and it will run through April. This was another great cooperative effort through the Cultural Council, Dale Sorensen, BG Polo, several restaurants in downtown. Anyway, but hoping that people will get to town and not be restricted because of walking, be able to go in the shuttle. Talk about Main Street.
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
Mr. Kramer has one more thing.
Well, I'll wait.
Okay. Just want to talk. The veterans have a terrific program for Operation Enduring Laughter, and this is for Friday, November the 13th. And the Veterans Council is offering any veteran who served in the last 25 years, active duty or reserves, a ticket dinner, two free dinners, and tickets to the comedy show at Riverside Theater. You can go by 8:30, have your dinner, and then go to the show. It's a real reach out from the Veterans Council to try to touch the younger veterans that, you know, we don't know are here or that might need some help. Might notice a lot of young baseball players out at historic Dodger Town. They're having the Baseball Youth Fall Championship this weekend. It's I said, it's eight to 13-year-olds. It's teams from across the Southeast are competing for top honors. So we want to welcome them all to our community.
That's okay. I attended the Beach and Shores Preservation Committee meeting yesterday, and they're probably going to be sending a resolution to us to oppose Dade County from creeping up the Treasure Coast and pulling sand. They've already approached Martin County and St. Lucie County, and one of the topics that was brought up is that that sand right now is designated for our county. It's our sand, and in particular, it's designated for Sector 5, which is the main stretch of beach running through the city of Vero Beach for a possible dune restoration project. So prepare to see that resolution coming to you all probably, I would think, in December, January, around that time.
Some comment on that. People generally don't know, but the two southern counties have insufficient sand any place. The alternates would be to go to the Bahamas, which has got a Department of State limitation.
And they're also going to push a resolution for the county to pass to put pressure on Congress to pull some of the things that are in the way of going to the Bahamas and getting the sand.
And the other thing would be to mine sand, but it would be very detrimental to us if you start taking sand offshore from us. What it does to our beaches is unknown, and we ourselves need the sand.
Well, so. We do. So, and then my second thing is Downtown Friday is October 30th, 5:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. There's a children's costume contest, an adult costume contest, and at 6:30 a wiener dog race. Dachshunds only. If you have a dachshund, you can enter them in. There's three categories: pepperonis, footlongs, and red hots. So that should be interesting to see. It says dachshunds only, though, so you can't bring your dog dressed as a dachshund. It has to be a dachshund. So with that, I'm wrapping up.
Mr. Kramer, back to you, and then we'll go to Ms. Roll.
Well, just one thing real quick. I was going to ask the council. I spent some time with the Veterans Council, and they do have a CD that describes their services to the veterans, and I was going to ask council if they had any problem with that, putting that on our loop and advertising that out to the public on our station.
That's great.
Okay.
Mr. Old.
I'm involved with the Vero Man site, and we are a consultative part of the All Aboard Florida. And so we've been invited to meetings in the last couple of days with All Aboard Florida, with the Federal Rail Agency, and a watchdog agency that's part of it. And we've all been able to voice our opinions about what the process is like. And also talk about mitigation and talk about the process and how it's gone on so far. I think, my own opinion, I think that the train is going to come through. We're not going to be able to stop it. We're not going to be able to really slow it down significantly. We can ask for mitigation issues that may come up, but that's about all we can really do. I'm going to spend some time with Monty and see if we can come up with some ideas about mitigation, because I think that's really important. And if you don't ask, you don't get. And so I think we can come up with a pretty good case for some things and ask. Vero Man is asking for some money to excavate ahead of time. Whether we get it or not, we don't know. But if you don't ask, you don't get. So we've got to do something. Also, in the last 6 months or so, I've heard a great deal about our vision plan. That we have a vision plan that was well done. I think it was finished in 2007 or something like that, and nothing's really happened to it, because from 2007 to now, we've gone through this down spiral. And I wonder if there's a way or an idea of saving it by updating it, going back to the people that wrote it and asking them to update it. I think that what I've heard is a lot of good things about it, and a lot of effort went into it, and it was a major expense, and nothing's happened to it. And I think it might be prudent to go back to them and see what would happen, how much it would cost, and how long it would take to modernize it, basically. I just wonder what people thought about it.
We can have Tim and Gary look into that and come back with some budgeting numbers.
Because I think there's going to be a lot, too, when our comprehensive plan finishes, that those two can kind of meld together.
Yeah, I think if we did the comp plan and then we did then an update of the vision plan, we'd really be back on track.
We're looking, I think it was February or March, maybe?
For the comprehensive plan. We're using a consultant on part of that.
Maybe look to piggyback those.
I think it was Gould Evans or somebody that did it, I think, that did the vision plan. Anyway.
Okay. It was really the citizens of Vero Beach, because there's meeting after meeting after meeting.
Yes, indeed. So very much, the public was very much involved in it, and it was very big, wide participation. Yeah, indeed. Yep.
All right. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
We're adjourned.
Thank you.